Now then, my friend, may I offer you a little refreshment? Your usual whiskey and soda, perhaps?
No, thanks, Poirot. It's a little early in the day.
As you wish. You do not object if I drink a little tisane?
Of course not, though I can never understand what you see in that disgusting stuff.
And while I sip my tisane, there is something I would like you to take a look at, Hastings. It came by this morning's post. Read it.
Mr. Hercule Poirot, you fancy yourself, don't you, at solving mysteries that are too difficult for our thick-headed British police. Let us see how clever you can be. Perhaps you'll find this not too hard to crack. Look out for Andover on the 21st of the month. Yours, ABC.
We present John Moffatt as Hercule Poirot in Agatha Christie's The ABC Murders.
It was the June of 1935. I'd been away in South America for some time, and when I came back to England, my first thought was to call on my old friend Hercule Poirot. He was looking wonderfully well, hardly a day older than when I'd last seen him. Even his grey hairs seemed to have vanished.
Ah, but you have such a beautifully unsuspicious mind, my friend. Examine this bottle.
Revive it, to bring back the natural tone of the hair, in five shades. Poirot, you've dyed your hair. So that's why you're looking in such fine fettle.
Ah, no, my friend. It is not simply the revive it. It is the constant exercise of the little grey cells. Just when I fear the time has come to retire and grow the vegetable marrows, another murder comes along. I am like the prima donna who makes positively the farewell performance, and that performance, it repeats itself an indefinite number of times.
But for all my old friend's gaiety and vivacity, I could see that something was troubling him. Was it the letter from the mysterious ABC?
Perhaps. What do you think, mon ami?
Some madman or other, I suppose.
Very probably. But a madman is always to be taken seriously.
What have you done about it?
What can I do? I showed it to Inspector Japp. He is of the same opinion as you. They get these things every day at Scotland Yard. But nevertheless, there is something about that letter that I do not like. Something that is wrong. But I cannot say precisely what it is.
Well, the 21st is on Friday. If a whacking great train robbery takes place at Andover on Friday...
Ah, what a comfort that would be.
How can a robbery possibly be a comfort?
Because it would dispossess my mind of the fear of something else.
Something else?
Murder, Hastings. Murder.
Good morning. I would like a second-class ticket to Andover, please.
Andover. And will you be travelling today, sir?
Oh, yes. By the next train. I want to get there as soon as possible.
But Friday the 21st of June came and went, and there were no reports from Japp of anything amiss in Andover.
I was wrong. I thought there was something of the odour of fish about that letter. Instead, a mere stupidity. Alas, I grow old and suspicious, like the blind watchdog who growls when there is nothing there.
So, now you're disappointed of being cheated of a really juicy crime.
Juicy? Oh, what a terrible word. Now, I admit that I would like to have been confronted by something recherché, something rare.
And what would be your ideal murder mystery, Poirot?
A very simple crime. A crime with no complications. A crime that was unimpassioned, anteam.
Well, how can a crime be anteam?
Supposing that four people sit down to play bridge, and one, the odd man out, sits in a chair by the fire. At the end of the evening, that man is found dead. Mm. One of the four, while he is dummy, has gone over and killed him, and, intent on the play of the hand, the other three have not noticed. Ha-ha! There would be a real crime.
I can't see any excitement in that.
Ah, well, that is because you have the melodramatic soul, Hastings. For you, there must be the curiously twisted dagger, the stolen eye of the god, the beautiful woman with auburn hair. Now, you would like not one murder, but a series of murders.
I must admit that a second murder in a book can often cheer things up. If the murder happens in the first chapter and you have to follow up everybody's alibi until the last page but one, it can get a bit tedious. Hello? Oh, good morning. He's just here. It's Japp for you.
Yes, Chief Inspector?
It looks as if I spoke a bit too soon. There was a murder in Andover last night.
And who was it that was killed?
An old woman by the name of Ascher. She kept a little tobacco and newspaper shop. Andover police think they can put their hand on the man that did it, but they'd like to have a look at that anonymous letter of yours. And in view of your involvement, I thought I might stretch a point of protocol and go down there myself. Uh-huh. Perhaps you and Captain Hastings might care to join me on the 10:15 from Waterloo.
When did they find the body?
At 1 o'clock this morning. A constable was going on his rounds and noticed that the shop door was unfastened. He went in and found the body huddled behind the counter. It looks as if she was struck down by a heavy blow on the back of the head while she was reaching up for a packet of cigarettes from the shelf.
And do they know when the murder took place?
Well, they've narrowed it down to between 5:30 and 6 o'clock.
And who is the man they reckon committed the murder?
Her husband. He's a German. And a very unpleasant piece of goods, by all accounts. He had a job as a waiter for a time, but he took to drink, made himself quite unemployable. He's got the shakes, which doesn't do much for you when you're serving at table. They separated years ago, but he used to come round every now and then to get money out of her for drink. Sometimes he'd get quite violent, apparently.
And what does he say?
Rather what you'd expect, that he was off on a pub crawl with his mates.
Was anything taken from the shop?
Not so as you'd notice. But there was one thing that might interest you, Poirot. Mm. There was a railway guide turned face down on the counter. Open at Andover.
A Bradshaw or an ABC?
An ABC.
So, it is not a coincidence. That was clearly meant for me.
Some old enemy of yours, perhaps. Anyway, if it's all the same with you, Poirot, I'd like to take a look at the body as soon as it's convenient.
She must have been beautiful once.
What makes you say that?
Look at the line of the jaw, the moulding of the head. Do they think much force would have been needed to strike the blow?
You mean could a 70-year-old alcoholic with shaky hands have done it? They reckon so.
So it could equally well have been done by a woman?
Suppose it could.
And did the dead woman have any children?
No. There is a niece, I believe. Very reliable, by all accounts. She's in service at a house near Overton.
That is far from here?
A couple of miles at most.
Then I should like to go and talk to her straight away.
Wouldn't it be better to go to the scene of the crime?
No. I prefer to do that later. Do you know the name of this niece, Inspector Japp?
Just a minute. I've got it written down somewhere. Here it is. Mary Drower.
She was very good to me. Always. She brought me up after my mother died.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.